Assalamualaikum, my name is Fadwa Wazwaz, and I'm doing a presentation today on the last section of chapter 4 of the book that I published, God Intervenes Between a Person and Their Heart, Key Lessons from the Prophets. I began this particular chapter with the names of God, and it was Al-Ba'ith. And a way to think of Al-Ba'ith is the awakener, the resurrector, arouser, the dispatcher. And I went from that section into discussing lessons on repentance and forgiveness from Adam, Eve, Satan, and the angels. And I discussed quite a few lessons that we can extract from that particular story and we in the Quran, as well as that we get from the sayings and hadith of Prophet Muhammad, on and peace and blessings. I transitioned into a section titled Rationalization and the Healthy Heart. And I used, if you will, a perception of Christopher Hitchens, you know, his worldview, and then his criticism of God or the rejection of faith. And I tried to show how some of that perception, you know, without going into like a bashing of Christopher Hitchens like he had done in quite a few videos of God, just looking at his own perception and then in his own words and in his own actions over time, how that was a perception of his reality. As Carl Jung said, perception is projection. In today's presentation, I will also do something quite similar in the section of let your fear of God be deeply embedded in love. Now, this is again the last section of chapter 4, how do we fear God? And it's meant to summarize all the sections and all the lessons of this particular chapter. And so the example I will use, or the case in point, is Prophet Muhammad, upon him peace and blessings. So to begin, you know, why fear? Why do I want to use the word fear? Why not use just God is love? And I'm not here, you know, throwing shade at any faith community, but explaining our worldview of let your fear of God be deeply embedded in love. Now, there's a healthy fear and there's an unhealthy fear. Always we generalize, you know, if, for example, we have experiences with tyrants, abusers, individual who are disordered, we tend to generalize and make assumptions that therefore anyone who tries to shake us up or wake us up or help us to motivate us to a better understanding or growth of ourselves or our community, that means that that person is vindictive or tyrannical. And a lot of times this is how scripture is read. So arguments that ask why or question God come from a false worldview that is against Islam. I use the quote by Martin Luther King Jr. just because people have a lot of respect for him, and to explain that not all fear comes from disordered or tyrannical people. That's why I use the name Al-Ba'ith, the one who wakes us up or shakes us. Normal fear motivates us to improve our individual and collective welfare, while abnormal fear constantly poisons and distorts our inner lives. So he's a civil rights leader, and he has experienced, obviously, racism and fear from the KKK and other racists. And so he knows the difference between a tyrannical or an abuser or a tyrant, fear coming meant to push you down and keep you down, versus fear like there's climate issue that we need to attend to. There's COVID-19 issue that we need to attend to. There's like this normal fear that's meant to bring us together to improve our individual and collective welfare. So we have to differentiate between healthy, normal fear that's meant to instigate us to grow, instigate us to develop, and this unhealthy fear, which aims to keep us down, aims to inhibit our growth, aims to control us, enslave us. So we have to make that differentiation between both. And I think a lot of times when we read scripture, or when we listen to the words of God, we don't make that distinction. We don't differentiate the way Pharaoh has oppressed the children of Israel, and the way currently Israel is criminalizing all human rights, or six human rights organizations to continue its ongoing ethnic cleansing campaign. The way some Muslim countries, you know, will oppress the marginalized in their own community. So it's, we see these human rights issues and how people use fear as a way to carpet bomb people into submission. And we project that onto God. And it's important that we make that distinction so that we recognize unhealthy fear from healthy fear that comes from God and Ba'ath, that's meant to, again, bring us to take care of our individual and collective welfare. Another reason for this topic is people want the right to be angry at perceived injustices against them, but God cannot be angry with them. Here I use God because oftentimes, such individuals, while they feel entitled to be angry, entitled to be vindictive, and then they will start putting God on the prosecution stand, like I showed in last section with Christopher Hitchens. You know, why is he being angry? Why is he being vengeful? When he's not being vengeful, he's being just. People want justice for themselves and loved ones, but question God's capability to be judge. And this is the, we're talking about like the Ten Commandments or the moral law that was sent down, that we don't trust God's capability to be judge because we're only really looking at our own interests, our interests for our loved ones, but we're not really looking at, again, the collective welfare of society, whether it's domestic or international. To begin, it's important that we understand there's a way, there's many ways that we could lie. And in terms of faith, one of the ways, as I had mentioned in this chapter, that we do lie is through omission. There's a major part to the story of God and his creation that has been constantly like shoved under the carpet, or constantly, if you will, omitted. And hence, we're kind of presenting facts selectively in a way that we think we're arriving at the truth, or we think that we're raising a good argument, when in reality, we are being ungrateful, or we are lying via omission. And we are presenting facts, but there are certain facts that were we to present, it would give a more honest and a more, if you will, clear understanding of the situation. In this particular presentation, what I'm getting at is that when God created human beings, to distinguish between like the fear that comes out of Pharaoh and the fear that comes out of, like God says, you know, fear of God. You know, it's not a fear of, don't hit me, don't, you know, it's not like that. It's, you know, like if there's a child that's, you're giving them privileges, and they're just being defiant and ungrateful and transgressing the boundaries. You know, if you discuss it with like a therapist or a counselor, they will say, well, take away the privileges. Now, if we look at it in that relationship with God, the origin of the story is that we honor the children of Adam. We provided them with transport on land and sea, given them for sustenance things good and pure, and conferred on them special favors above a great part of creation. So it was not a fear meant again to keep us down, to keep us subdued, that God needed to, you know, us to feel low and bad so he could feel God, you know, like the Pharaoh oppressing the children of Israel. But no, he's giving us all these provisions, all this honor, all this, you know, special favors above great part of the creation. Learning creatures, you know, gave us a position that even the angels questioned why it didn't go to them. This is the type of honor that God gave us. And that part is sort of omitted. We have never obviously experienced that from a tyrant or an abuser or someone vengeful or vindictive where they go out of their way to honor you and help you and give you privileges and special favors and all of these blessings. And then they start, you know, using fear as a way to keep you down. That's not the way the story really began. So there's also another verse in the Quran. It says, consider the fig and the olive. Now those are just two trees of many trees and many, again, sustenance that are good and pure, that are packed with benefits for the human body, and Mount Sinai and the land secure. Now the chapter is called At-Tin, or the fig. It references really the moral law. And it shows that if we follow the moral law, that we continue to be in that state of honor and that state of, you know, sustenance and blessings. And if we violate or transgress that moral law, then we end up harming ourselves, but worse still is we end up bringing harm to others and innocent people. So it ends with, what then, O man, could henceforth cause thee to give the lie to this moral law? Is not God the most just of judges? So this is kind of a response, if you will, to the last section where Christopher Hitchens questioned the Ten Commandments and the moral law of God. So we're always thinking again with respect of our interests and our right for justice, but we're not thinking that we are citizens of a community that has other creations, and that when we violate that law, it is going to impact other creation and bring them harm. And so while we're asking these questions, like why do children die from cholera, we're ignorant of the fact that on the day of judgment, that question will be posed to us. Why did children die from cholera? While we may blame God, the reality is God will turn the question to us, that had we followed the moral law, then children would not have died from cholera. If we look at the beginning of the chapter, I gave an example. It's a documentary about the Chernobyl incident. And not to say, again, we don't believe that human beings are toxic, but documentary showed after the Chernobyl nuclear incident that when human beings, when that particular place became a dead man zone and human beings were removed, that over time, all the creation, you know, they're the plants and the animals, there were wolves, bisons, horses, everything, they all started to flourish. And, you know, following again that moral law of God, they all started to flourish. So it's not our presence that makes, if you will, that created that atrocity, but it's our violations of the moral law that brought about that Chernobyl incident and harmed not just the people who were directly involved, but innocent people in the community that are not directly involved. To continue further, it's important to note that God is not a human being. So sometimes our questions are not just rationalizing, but they are foolish. Now, this is really pointing at an argument that was raised, if you will, by a teacher. His name is Ramadan Bhuti. So if you research on YouTube, he has, did God create us to punish us? And no, God did not create us to punish us, but we are treating God like a human being and we're asking questions that may make sense if you were to ask a human being, but are kind of foolish if you are asking of God, because God does not have needs and he does not also have goals, if you will. So when he wants to create something, he says, be, and it is. For us, he gives the example that we have goals. Like if we want to achieve something, then we have certain means. So the question of why is, why are you digging that hole? He says, well, because you're trying to build a well, and that well is meant to help you with gardening or help you with bringing water maybe to the people in the community or that particular village. So there, that's a mean to a goal. Whereas for God, he can say be and it is. He doesn't have a goal or he's not limited to means. It's also his universe and his creation. He doesn't owe you or anyone an explanation. I think at times it's hard for people to swallow that, but they have to understand that God is not a human being that can be put on the prosecution stand and questioned as one would question a human being. The other thing is that there's a verse in the Quran that says, what can Allah gain by your punishment? If you are grateful and you believe, nay, it's Allah that recognizes all good and knows all things. So I mentioned how we tend to lie by omission, by overlooking this. These are just two verses in the Quran, but there are quite a few verses that mentions about the honor that God has given creation, the special favors. If you read the chapter of Ar-Rahman, where he says, that he taught humanity about intelligence. He taught them even the faculties of reasoning, how to write, language, all of these tremendous blessings that he's taught human beings. So this is, again, the omission when we're saying, why do bad things, happen? We seem to forget a good part of that chapter of our connection to God. But the other thing is we forget that God has no needs. He has nothing to gain by anything good we do for him, or, like our worship or fasting. He doesn't gain anything by it. And he's not harmed by our transgressions. We are harmed. God is not harmed. The angels are not harmed. We are harmed by those transgressions. And he's, what does he gain by punishing us? He doesn't gain anything. The punishment is a form of justice. It's meant to be, wake us up, like I began the chapter, the awakener, the resurrector. It's meant to say you've transgressed bounds that it's within the interests of society that you be punished. So he has nothing to gain by punishment, but society, the welfare of society has something to gain. And I give an example of, in the book, that God is, you know, patient, loving, but he gives opportunity after opportunities to repent, feel remorse, change our habits, and grow. Punishment comes into the picture only when it becomes evident to God and to everyone around that an individual is not receptive to growth. Indeed, God gives us many opportunities to see our actions through others' eyes. And I gave an example of Pharaoh, surrounded not only by the slaves whom he dehumanized and oppressed, but also by people of light and goodness who lived in his own home. These were people who he respected, namely Asya, his wife, and her adopted son, Moses, upon him peace. Pharaoh also had a pious, wise advisor, and there were others in his kingdom who tried to steer him toward a better way, to the intertwined love and fear of God. But none of these good people were able to have an impact on Pharaoh. His arrogance and narcissism were simply too deep-seated. So yes, God is loving, he's merciful, he's compassionate, and yes, he's patient. And he's also very generous, as I have shown in the verses in the Quran. And as we are witnessing, like when you witness the sunrise, and you witness the sunset, and you witness all, you know, like end of summer, went to visit Duluth, just tremendous amount of beauty everywhere that you see around you. You don't need to even go like for too far out. So all of the blessings, the different and various types of fruits that we are given, pure and good to eat, that benefit our bodies. So you see that tremendous amount of generosity and goodness. There comes a time for justice. Now, we shouldn't fear God because we believe God is vindictive, as Christopher Hitchens said. But we have to fear God because he doesn't only care only about a select elite. God is compassionate and cares about everyone. Instead, we fear God because God is majestic. Again, this is not an unhealthy fear of someone who's an abuser or torturer, but someone who's majestic and just. And so this majesty should bring about not our quavering, and I'll give examples through the words of Prophet Muhammad, but our humility. It should help us to authentically know our limitations. In the case of Pharaoh, you know, he became deluded and he just did not know his limitations. And he felt because he got away and got away and got away and got away that he will continue to get away. So he goes through the Red Sea in a state of complete delusion. And he ends up doing what? He ends up getting drowned because there comes a time for justice. So fear of God is a positive force. The fear of God indeed is nudges us always to do right. This fear that compels us to get to know others in spite of our differences. This fear also presses us to be humble and not to transgress the boundaries of others. For instance, at times when marginalized groups express anger and rage, it can hit our ears in a difficult way. Maybe the way in which people express their anger sounds harsh and it's hard for us to hear. But the fear of God, again, this is why it's a positive force, forces us to hear the pain and struggle of groups, for example, the recent Black Lives Matter movement. Indeed, the fear of God also should humble us so that we can hear marginalized communities in pain. This is particularly true, again, of communities who are saying, I need you to hear me right now. I need you to listen. Like Native Americans, you know, it's years, you know, where they're trying to be heard and understood about the pain that they have experienced from their dispossession, the land that they've lost, and just the constant, again, encroachment into the reservations that and the land that they do have. The fear of God should humble us so that we can hear these communities, like I said. It's a healthy fear, just as our body sends us a message of pain when it's ill, telling us we need to tend to it. The fear of God should send a similar message when we're about to cause harm to ourselves or others. In the Quran, I gave an example of Satan is not an angel, but instead he's a jinn, and he, like other jinn and humans, have the power to obey or disobey God. Now, if Adam is the father leader of human beings, then Satan is the same for jinn. Once Satan was an avid worshiper of God. Then along came this newcomer, Adam, who wasn't made from fire like the jinn, but instead from lowly clay. Satan didn't want to know Adam. He felt that given all he'd done, God owed him something. The angels recognized that Adam was a special being. Satan was also invited to that journey to recognize the special aspects of Adam, but he rejected it. Satan felt that because he was made of smokeless fire, he was better than Adam. Moreover, Satan didn't fear God. So we could see again an individual here who has absolutely no fear of God. Of course, he could say it on his lips, but just saying it on your lips while you're plotting and planning from every direction to mislead, to misguide, to turn people away from God is not a fear of God. And I'll give again examples from the words, the supplications of Prophet Muhammad. Satan was very worshipful, but he had no fear. It was this lack of fear that made him violate the boundaries, not just of God. Now, you can't harm God, so it's not violating in the sense that he was successful, because the Quran says, you know, they try, you know, Satan's try to, when God decrees a matter, sends it to the angels to implement it. They try to know so that they can go and solve mischief on earth, and they're hit with meteors or blazing fire. And so all of this is an attempt to bring Adam down. But it also that when you have no fear of God, you actually have no respect, if you will, for the boundaries of others. You're always looking for ways to transgress those boundaries. So where he should have felt fear, Satan instead felt entitlement. And we see this in human relations. People who fear of God fear that if they violate another human being, you know, begins with fear. That's why it has to be fear embedded with love. But, you know, if they keep, they're kind of like two hands clasped together. And they both, you know, keep you from going in one direction or the direction, the straight path to God. And I'll explain that with the supplications. So as we go forth with the supplication that I'm about to discuss, let me just take a moment and say that the truthful prayer or supplication here we're referring to, it's not a plea or a request of being in lack, but it's a prayer of gratitude. It's an acknowledgement of, first and foremost, this reality, that part of the story that seems to be omitted. So that supplication recognizes that original story. And the reason is when you pray with a plea, your request is a statement of lack and encourages a constant focus on a feeling of being short of Allah's mercy. What happens is if you do that, you start to be blind to that part of the story. And it's important that we keep reminding ourselves of this reality of that original story. So that when we are praying in a state of gratitude. But of course, we're recognizing our need, our human limitations. Not that God failed us or forgot about us or erred in giving us. This conveys, again, a sense of lack of gratitude to Allah Almighty and therefore recreates the perception of being lacking in life. So to move forth, I said for this particular section, it's good to also have a role model that we can follow. I'm not going to use myself or others out there, but I think the best role model to show how fear embedded in love would be Prophet Muhammad, upon him peace and blessings. So how do we reconcile fear and love with one for God? It's gratitude. you know, if you are grateful for this, you're acknowledged. And again, there are other verses, but I'm just trying to be brief here. And your mind and your perception and your memory of the story does not omit, you know, lying via omission, does not omit this part of the story, then you're constantly afraid of losing that relationship with a loving, a patient, a generous, a kind Lord. It's a, not a fear of, I'm gonna torture you into submission. It's a fear of, I recognize this, I see this, I recall this, I know you, you're a loving God, you're a generous God, you're a great God. And I don't wanna lose that relationship with you. I don't wanna lose that connection because I acknowledge this, I see this, I recall this, I bear witness to this. So it's that type of fear. It's a fear embedded with love. That's the bedrock of it, is gratitude. So to begin with the supplications of Prophet Muhammad, he shares with us actually a supplication by Prophet David upon peace. So he says, "Oh Allah, I ask you for your love, the love of those who love you, the deeds which will cause me to attain your love. Oh Allah, make your love dearer to me than myself." This means the ego, and I'll show that in some of the supplications. My family and the cold water. It could also be like my country or whatever it is that's going to compete with your love of God. Because what you love drives you. If you love, you know, whatever it is, whatever object of your love, it will drive you such that when you are tested, you will judge not based on the moral law, but you will judge based on your love for that object. And you might end up bringing harm to yourself or bringing harm to others, innocent others as well. So to transition, you know, from that story of Adam and Eve and those who reject faith, if you will, says, "Oh, you who believe, if any from among you turn back from his faith," you know, God doesn't say, "I'm going to chase you and have people chase you and we'll, you know, torture you to come back to the faith." Because there is no compulsion in religion. This is not a fear of, like the way the Pharaoh ran after Moses. And they had so much petrified fear when they stood before the Red Sea. This is a fear of losing a connection with a loving, generous Lord. If any from you turn from faith, God will produce a people whom he will love as they will love him. Lowly with the believers, mean like humble, mighty against the rejectors, fighting in the way of God, never afraid of the reproaches of such as find fault. That's the grace of Allah, which he will bestow on whom he pleases. And Allah encompasses all, and he knows all things. So to transition forward, they say when you open your mouth, you tell people who you are. And so I felt a good way to introduce, you know, again, this sort of intertwined love, fear and love of God would be the supplications of Prophet Muhammad. What people supplicate or seek from people in power or God tells us a lot about who they are. So to begin, this is also another supplication by Prophet Muhammad, upon him peace and blessings. And he says, "Oh God, I ask you for," you know, he asks for well-being in the world and the hereafter. "I ask you for forgiveness and well-being in my religion, my worldly affairs. Oh Allah, conceal my faults, calm my fears, protect me from before me, behind me, my right, my left, from above me, and I seek refuge in you from being taken unaware from beneath me." So we all have reasonable fear from being, again, abused, from being oppressed, from being having people who plot and plan to harm us, either it is Satan or even human beings, that are attempting to look for a way to attack us. And obviously the story of Prophet Muhammad is he had faced many calculated attempts, plots, and plans to have to attack him. So sometimes those fears can, at a human level, they can turn into paranoia. And by turning to God and asking God to calm our fears and turning to him, asking for safety, well-being, security, these are the ways that the Prophet, upon him, peace and blessings, turned to God. Now, he didn't say, give me power to destroy each and every single one of them. But he asked for God first and foremost to protect him from all directions, including underneath. Ask for forgiveness and asking for safety, well-being. It's a bit more like not just well-being physically, but financially, mentally, emotionally, socially, spiritually, just to have a general well-being where you're not having something that you are preoccupied with and distracted with that you have to resolve and take care of. Another supplication of Prophet Muhammad, says, I seek refuge in your pleasure from your wrath, and your pardon from your punishment, and in you from you, and I cannot enumerate your praises as you praise yourself. That's a supplication to Prophet Muhammad. Now Aisha, may God be pleased with her, mentioned that supplication, and she said that the Prophet one night standing up in prayer, sitting it for so long that she thought the Prophet had passed away or died. So when she felt that way, she stood up, shook his toe because he was in prostration, and she felt the movement, then laid down near his head to try to hear what he was saying. And so she heard this prayer and relates it to us. There's many ways to look at this particular prayer, and I like this particular saying by Ali ibn Abu Talib about the ego. And I mentioned about, I ask it for you, for your love, and to make it greater than myself or the ego. So Ali ibn Abu Talib replied, one man asked Ali ibn Abu Talib about his ego, and he asked, of which one are you referring to become aware? So he said, is there more than one? And the man had asked, and Ali said, yes, there are four. There is the one of growth, again, that healthy fear meant to, like the tree, it's meant to make you grow and grow and grow and, continue to grow. The sensibility, like here is in the middle of the night, you would think that he would be devoting all his time just with his wife. Now, he sought permission always from his wife whenever he would wanted to pray extra prayers. And she said, although I preferred that you be with me, that she wanted him to be pleased, so she allowed him. So you would see again that the sensibility, or not the animal spirit, where some men just have no self-control around women. You can see his tremendous self-control, the pure intellect in his praising of God in prostration, and his connection to God. Excuse me. So each one of these, you might say, nafs has powers and qualities of its own. I don't want to go too much in detail commentary because that's not the aim, but just to reflect on it a little bit with this particular saying of Ali. So we learn about the different aspects that come into play with our true intentions towards any act. It tells us about his true intentions toward his marriage to Aisha. Was it because he's a womanizer? Who just had no self-control around women, with our true intention towards any person or thing, the level of self-interest affects the outcome. We might also learn that specific environments are debilitating and others lead to equilibrium. We might also understand that peace comes from God and not from our ego or others. After each prayer, Prophet Muhammad, our five daily prayers I'm referring to here, taught us to say, O Allah, you are peace, and from you comes peace. Blessed art thou, Most High, Lord of majesty and bounty. So we seek peace after every prayer from God Almighty. If we move forward still, you know, even though he was a prophet, the seal and leader of the prophets and the most resolute messenger, Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings, used to make this prayer to God. Wallah, I seek refuge in you, lest I misguide others. Or I am misguided by others, lest I cause others to err, or I am caused to err. Lest I abuse others or be abused. Lest I behave foolishly or meet with the foolishness of others. Closer look at the prayer shows his concern for others being harmed by him preceded his concern from being harmed by others. We can witness the genuine love of God, which is a concern for others, as the Quran describes them. For true servants of the Most Gracious are only they who walk gently on earth and who, whenever the foolish address them, reply with words of peace. Now, he put that, you know, phenomenally in practice while we're struggling, and all of us should admit to be struggling. You know, he passed all of these tests, and he's supposed to be the light of the way that he modeled all of this for us. But how many of us really, whenever we're trying to solve any problem in society, we really turn to God asking for protection or refuge, that we don't misguide others, misinform others, cause others to err, abuse others, or treat people foolishly? How many really, you know, make that turn and turn again and turn again to God, showing, if you will, respect toward his creation and respecting the moral law that guide, you know, and that protect all of his creation, not just, you know, oneself and one's loved ones? How many of us really do that? Again, you know, fear embedded in love. Now, this one is a very important one, and I sort of emphasized it in Arabic here, and I'll put it in bold in the English translation. As Muslims, we're grateful for how Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings, taught us to connect to God truthfully with pure intellect and clean hearts. Now, when you're turning to God and holding yourself, asking God or accepting God's right to hold you accountable, it's not an attempt that you want God to punish you and hit you or strike you. It's an acknowledgement of gratitude, an acknowledgement of one's sincerity, an acknowledgement, if you will, truthfulness, and just true servanthood to God, but also the gratitude that is embedded in that relationship and the love. So again, you say, we mentioned this a lot of times about Ta'if and the prayer that is made, and how he turns to God with the trial and the tribulation. And as long as you're not angry with me, then I don't care. You know, again, you could see that here he's more obsessed with kind of like Adam, but to a higher degree of love, if you will, that I acknowledge, again, it's this, I acknowledge that you're a loving God, you're a patient God, you're a generous God. And I'm worried about the relationship, the connection, that I may have done something that transgressed or angered you or displeased you. So it's not a fear of, again, your fear of being tortured, your fear of that connection, that love between you and God, of a loving, patient, you know, grateful, because God recognizes all things that you do. you're worried about that relationship, that connection. You're worried about that display, that him being displeased with you. So here, you know, he says, to you is the right to reprimand until you are pleased. Instead of holding God on the prosecution stand, putting God on the prosecution stand, he doesn't lie via omission by denying all the blessings or the original story and starting with just the trial and tribulation and generalizing it and awfulizing it and overlooking everything else. But he recognizes all that original story, but also the final destination and all yet the blessings. And he asks God, you know, that as long as you're not angry with me, then I don't care. And to use the right to reprimand until you are pleased. Why? Because he knows he's turning to a loving God. He knows he's turning to a patient God. He knows he's turning to the most kind, the most merciful. You can't be more merciful than God. So when you know someone and you know their nature, then obviously your fear is of losing them, of losing that love that you have for them, because you recognize and you're grateful for the blessings and you're grateful for the goodness that came out of a loving God. Again, it goes back to the question, what does God have to gain by punishing you? So when we turn to God, I believe I heard this from Ramadan al-Buti, I mentioned it before, and you're not again telling God to punish you, but you want to make sure that you have not done anything to anger or displease God. Now, it doesn't take much to please God. So if you're constantly trying to please God, and I was showing some of the supplications about pleasing God, that God also tries to please you as well. It's a very beautiful, if you will, relationship to reflect on. Now, faith doesn't have to be, in the way of faith, doesn't have to be very difficult and hard. Islamic worldview is discussed very, you know, wonderful here in this supplication. Oh God, make my religion easy for me by virtue of which my fears are protected. Set right for me my world where my life exists. None of us should be seeking trials and tribulations. They're not fun for ourselves or our loved ones. So we shouldn't be like saying, oh, give me trials and tribulations. You shouldn't be doing that. I know some people, believe it or not, who did ask God for trials and tribulations thinking that they can pass the test. You should never be praying for trials and tribulations. You should always be praying for well-being and ask God to make the hereafter, you know, a comfortable resort you have to return. In fact, it's obligatory that you pray that you go to heaven. It's obligatory that you pray that you don't go to hellfire. You shouldn't assume that you're not going there. It's obligatory to pray that, you know, you are not going to be punished in the grave. And so make my life prone to perform all types of good. That's the, you know, one of the things you would want to do is you look at the world as a farm and make death a comfort for me from every evil. We leave that judgment to God. No, I'm not telling anyone to like resort to committing suicide, but leave the matter of when you become weary of life or weary of the trial and tribulation, just turn the matter to God instead of turning it to yourself. Because sometimes the self will awfulize a particular snapshot of an experience you have, whether it's present, past, or fear of the future, and it will make you awfulize, and you overlook the present moment. So this is just something to sort of reflect on. Another thing you would want to reflect on is, this is another supplication by Prophet Muhammad, on peace and blessings, who taught us to say, to ask for steadfastness on the straight path. So I ask you for steadfastness in this matter, you know, to go, to be guided, and ask you for resolve to adhere to the path of guidance. And I ask you for gratitude for your blessings and to worship you well, and ask you for a truthful tongue and a sound heart. I seek refuge with you from the evil of what you know, and I ask you for the good of what you know, and I seek you, I ask you for forgiveness for what you know. You are the knower of the unseen. So it doesn't really benefit us to create videos bashing Christopher Hitchens. Rather, we should take it as lessons of what not to do. Likewise, to waste our time about all the tactics of Satan. A more appropriate thing would be to use that time and energy to turn to God and ask him to give us steadfastness, give us resolve, give us a clean heart. If his heart wasn't clean, then we turn to God and say, give us a clean heart. If he was not truthful and he was the arch deceiver, then we turn to God and say, make us truthful to you. If Adam failed in showing resolve, we take that lesson and we turn to God and ask for a resolve. We ask God to give us the good of what he knows, protect us from the evil of what he knows, like Satan or others that may be plotting and planning in the dark and we're not aware of. And that he's the knower of the unseen, because there are things that are beyond our perception, our human perception, for us to know. So it's an acknowledgement that we see a lot of lessons in the story of Adam and Eve and the angels and Satan. And we take those lessons and then we turn them into supplications to God, asking for the things that we know that we need to pass the test, and not just to pass, but to pass it beautifully. So we keep turning to God, take the lessons, learn what to do, learn what not to do, and take those lessons and turn them into prayers, not assume that we've arrived just by learning the lesson. Now, the next one is, how do we embrace the director? There's another, if you will, supplication. This was given to Salama, O mother of the believers. She's the wife of Prophet Muhammad, one of the wives of Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings. And so we learned the supplication from her. And so she was asked, what was the supplication that the Messenger of Allah, upon him, peace and blessings, said most frequently when he was with you? So she says, the supplication he said most frequently was, Ya muqallib al-qulub thabbit qalbi ala dinak. This is in Arabic, and in English it's overturner of the hearts, or changer of the hearts, if you will. Make my heart firm upon your religion. So she says, so I said, this is her asking, O Messenger of Allah, why do you supplicate so frequently, O changer of the hearts, make my heart firm upon your religion? So he says, O Salama, verily there is no human being except that his heart is between two fingers of the fingers of God. So whomever he wills, he makes steadfast, and whomever he wills, he causes to deviate. So God knows what's in people's hearts. And if he senses that you're trying to trick people, and again, misguide people, mislead people, transgress the boundaries of people, and you're abusing, misapplying the faith, over time, you know, after reminders and warnings, just kind of like that Satan is given, you know, here's how the angel surrendered, here's how Adam repented. If you keep continually rejecting these chances and opportunities to surrender and repent, then God allows you to deviate. Again, fear embedded in love. When he allows you to deviate, it means that you're losing connection to a loving, patient, kind Lord. It's not a fear where he's coming after you the way Pharaoh came after Moses and the children of Israel and wanted to destroy them. And we don't just want to be on the straight path, you know, like our heart now is kind of like you position your heart and now you're focused toward the final destination, the straight path. But you also want your limbs to be either crawling, limping, walking, running, flying. You want to be you know, your limbs to move on the straight path. So Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with them, reported the Messenger of Allah upon him, peace and blessings, supplicated, O Director of the heart, direct our hearts to your obedience. So we want the heart to be focused on the straight path and show resolve, but we also want the lips to move and to, you know, kind of to keep walking on the straight path as we should. It's also good to look at some of the daily supplications. Like I said, there are many supplications that show us again that fear embedded in love. Abdullah bin Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, reported when it was morning, the Prophet upon him, peace and blessings, used to supplicate, we have entered upon the morning. Again, the awakener. They say sleep is like a small, if you will, a minor death. It gives you a taste of what it will be like when you are going to be resurrected on the day of judgment. We have entered upon the morning, and the whole kingdom of God entered upon the morning. Again, the whole kingdom of God. Praise is due to Allah. There is none who has the right to be worshipped but God, the one who has no partner with him. He, the narrator, said, I think that he upon him, peace and blessings, used to follow the recitation with these words. Allah belongs all sovereignty. Again, his universe, you know, his dominion. So it's very important to keep that in mind. And all praise is for God, and he is omnipotent, and he's powerful. My Lord, I beg of you good that lies in this morning and good that follows it. And I seek refuge in you from the evil that lies in this morning, from the evil of which follows it. My Lord, I seek refuge in you from lethargy, the misery of old age, you know, like when you cannot function. Nobody wants to be at an age where you're just not functioning and enjoying your life at all. And you need maybe 24 hours, 7 days a week care. Nobody wants to be in that state, unless some people, of course, want and they're praising God. But some people don't want to be in that state. Oh God, I seek your protection from the torment of hellfire, which is obligatory for us to turn to God and ask. We shouldn't assume that we have a one-way ticket to heaven. And to also ask God not to be punished from the grave. So that's not just for people who are non-Muslims. That's also for people, particularly people who are Muslims, obligatory to pray for protection from the punishment of the grave, as well as the torment of hellfire. So again, fear embedded in love. Now, a lot of times when you discuss, again, fear, excuse me, some individuals will bring in the issue of self-love and trying to like say in a way that is not misconstrued, but whoever says when he enters the morning or the evening, I am pleased with God as a Lord, with Islam as a religion, and with Muhammad as a prophet, it will be a duty upon Allah to please him. If you've ever studied oppressors or abusers, whatever you try to do, like there's so many songs about him, whatever you try to do to please them, they're never pleased. If you try to do this or that, or this or that, they're just never pleased. And people come out of that relationship trying to please and please and please and please. And what happens is it gets into a lot of discussions. And if you've been following it all over the internet, sometimes on social media, nonstop discussions on self-love versus narcissism. And so what happens is people come out of this where they're trying so hard to please, 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 please somebody, and that person is just not pleased. And as I began this presentation, I started with the prayer of Prophet Muhammad, which was, he shared of Prophet David, which is I ask of you of your love and the love of those who love you and the deeds that will help me attain your love, but to make that love greater than myself, the ego, family. Again, it could be a family member that you're trying to please. It could be your countrymen. It could be children. It could be spouse. It could be whoever it is, you know, somebody in your life that you're trying to please and they're not pleased. And you try to please and they're not pleased. Now, the solution, people usually come out of that relationship after like exhausting themselves, trying to please, then they kind of give up and they say, I need to learn self-love. And so they start to then say, you know, I love myself as a way to repair the harm this never pleased person made. But a more, if you will, healthy way of dealing with that is to wake, like when you wake up in the morning or the evening, is to say, I am pleased as God as my Lord. Again, to make the love of God greater than myself, my family, now again, it could be like country people, friends, whatever, greater than all of these, you know, individuals. So you don't want to go from loving somebody who's never pleased and then into love of the ego, love of the self. You know, the pendulum goes to love of people and to then love of ego, love of people, love of ego. You don't want to go into that pendulum back and forth. What you want to do is that the person's pleased, you ask yourself, what are the person's rights that God is going to question me about? Or are they fulfilled? Did I fulfill the obligations, the rights? If they're narcissistic, they're not narcissistic, that's not your problem. You're not going to be asked if they're narcissistic or not. Even people who are narcissistic, they may have rights upon you. Fulfill those rights. They're pleased, good. They're not pleased. You ask yourself and you check your heart, is God pleased? And then just wake up in the morning and the evening instead of self-love affirmations or in trying to, you know, pump your ego, turn it into I'm pleased with God. I fulfill this never pleased person in my life according to what God wants me to do. Now, they're not responding with being happy. That's not my responsibility. The result and the outcome is not going to, God is not going to ask me about the result or outcome. I just fulfilled what God is going to ask me about. I am happy with God. I'm happy with, you know, the moral law, if you will. Islam is my religion. And with Muhammad, Quran, and peace and blessings as a prophet. So it is a duty upon God to then please this individual. To go forth into that, again, self-love versus love of God, Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings, taught us to say, glories to Allah and praises to him by the multitude of his creation, by his pleasure, by the weight of his throne, by the extent of his words. So keep, again, praising God, when you're in a situation where you're dealing with people who are just not pleased. Don't go to find another set of friends who are pleased, and don't go to the ego who to please it, but just go straight to God and praise God. You know, you're not really interested in another set of group of people who are one day they'll please, the next day they're not pleased, then they're pleased. That's really how human creation is. So it's like, just go to God and praise God. Another one on self-love versus love of God. The, Dr. Omar Farooq Abdullah said that the ego is more powerful than 70 Satans. And if we look again about the supplications of Prophet Muhammad, he says, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from the inability to do good. You know, there is a value to the ego because we need it to be able to do things. We need it to be able, otherwise we'll be apathetic and depressed and not do anything. Indolence, cowardice, miserliness, decrepitude, and the torment of the grave. Grant me the sense of piety and purify my soul, as you are the best to purify. You are its guardian and its protecting friend. O Allah, I seek refuge in you from the knowledge which is not beneficial, from a heart which does not fear you. Now again, this is not a fear like Moses ran from the Pharaoh, but a heart that, like, you know, Satan, I don't care, you know, if you're unhappy, you're displeased with my actions. You know, God gave him power. God answered his prayer. God didn't tell Adam to go run after him and, you know, attack him and bash him, bring him back. But a fear of losing a loving, patient, kind, generous Lord, you know, that it's a form of ingratitude. You don't want a heart that just, I don't care. You want a heart that cares, that responds with gratitude to this loving Lord. And from desire which is not satisfied, from supplication which is not answered. Now I gave like two sort of video, if you will. Let me just try to open this one here. I just want to show this particular. So what I was trying to show, look at it. The horse represents the ego, and the rider, the horse rider, represents the soul, if you will. So what we want, like typically what we are hoping for, is that, again, that God gives us this piety, this strength, and this purification of the soul, that he makes it guard. We don't want to destroy the ego, but guard and be a protecting, that he's a protecting friend for the soul. That whenever the ego tries to throw off the rider or throw off the soul, that God will, if you will, protect it, as we have just seen. That whenever the ego tries to, it's a bit more powerful than 70 saints, when it tries to like betray the soul, that God will be his protecting friend and subdue the ego to the soul. So we want that type of protection. So we turn to God asking, again, we don't want to destroy our ego. You don't want to say ego is bad, but we don't want it to be like in the state, which is right here. So let me just open this particular link. Let's see, this is now competition, horse, rider, competing. But if you look at it, I'm just kind of fast forward a little bit into it. But he throws the rider off and he just competes alone. And if you just leading for a few more seconds, everyone trying to calm the horse down, trying to bring it to put the rider back on, and he just bulldozes through. No one can kind of stop it because it's kind of running and competing on its own. And the rider, again, he represents the soul. So just to give you a little bit of brief, you can go look at the whole thing. Horse knocks off rider and finishes competition alone. So you could see that, if you will, on your own, if you'd like. But this is one of the things that we would like to be protected from. We want to be protected from where our ego becomes, like, you know, so powerful, like 70 Satans, that it will betray the soul, and it will just kick off the soul, and it will just bulldoze through in life, totally unguided, untamed by the soul. So we turn to God, asking God for that type of guidance, if you will. Self-love versus love of God. Again, Imran ibn Hussein, may Allah be pleased with them, reported that the Prophet taught my father two statements to recite in his dua. Oh Allah, inspire in me guidance and deliver me from the evils within myself. And just to touch base on that, Carl Jung said, the more loudly you proclaim something, the inverse is true. It's your shadow. So if you're constantly like, you know, strengthening your self-love, affirmations, self-love, what happens is you're overlooking the shadow. And that you may, in this point, love yourself. There will come a trial, and that love will manifest the shadow, which is the self-hatred. Now becomes all ego. And a way to think about it is the way C.S. Lewis, who said, humility is not thinking less of yourself. Like, we don't want you to hate yourself. So the solution is not to hate yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. You know, so again, you don't want to go from people to self-love, or even self-love to self-hate, the shadow, and then, you know, self-love to self-hate. Whether the illness is self-hate, or it's self-love, because it can lead to narcissism. It can lead to the ego overthrowing the soul. The cure is really the same, to praise God. You know, someone's pleased. Did you please God by fulfilling the rights of this person that God is going to ask of you? Yes, then just, you know, please God. And did you please, you know, the individuals around you, according to what God will ask of you, and then just praise God. And so it goes like that. That way you're not attached to trying to please the ego, or trying to please, if you will, a never pleased individual in your life. Our needs, you know, Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, reported, a slave who has made a contract with his master to pay for his freedom came to me and said, I am unable to fulfill my obligation, so help me. He said to him, shall I not teach you a supplication which the messenger of God, upon him peace and blessings, taught me? You will surely prove so effective that if you have a debt as large as a huge mountain, Allah will surely pay it for you. So I share it here because we're in a time of a pandemic and people are hurting. Now, the idea is not to give people charity or not to help people, but it's also for those who are in the state of need to turn to God, so that when the charity, in fact, even comes to you, or the job comes to you, or the opening comes to you, it comes through ways that go from not slave to another slave. You know, like you believe you're now a slave to an economic slave. But it comes through from slavery, whatever type of slavery that you are then put under, into freedom. So grant me enough of what you make lawful, so that I may dispense with what you make unlawful, and enable me by your grace to dispense with all but you. So you want to be free of slavery, economic slavery as well. And you also want to be independent, and turning to God also in gratitude for that, and helping to share that gift with those around you that are in need, because you've learned from that lesson, given the people that God have used or the jobs that you were offered, how to be similarly kind to others, and not, use whatever you give them as a way of nonstop reminding them of the good you've, so that they feel like now they're slaves to the good that you've done to them. You've done it for God, by God, for God. Again, you're pleasing God. You're not trying to please people. supplication directed by God. And praying the small watches of the morning, it would be an additional prayer or spiritual profit for thee. Soon will thy Lord raise thee to a station of praise and glory. Now, this is a supplication that God told Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings, to make. So he says, say, O my Lord, let my entry be by the gate of truth and honor, and likewise my exit by the gate of truth and honor, and grant me from thy presence and authority to aid me. So again, we began about the origin of the story, which is that we were created in an honorable state, and that God has showered on us, you know, all of this good things, good and pure, special favors above all of creation. And like I said, if you read, there's a chapter called the Ar-Rahman, or the Most Merciful, that if you read, it talks about all the different, just some of the countless ways to reflect on some of the blessings that God has sent to you. And we want to enter, you know, into the next world by that, you know, we entered into this world, you know, when we receive the divine breath in heaven, in the state of honor and truth. We want to exit, you know, when we entered, you know, from our mother's womb, it's in, again, truth and honor. We want to exit this world into the next world by truth and honor. We want to be resurrected again by the gates of truth and honor. We want the help and the support from God to continue that straight path, again, acknowledging the honor that we were created in the gates that we came through, and as well to exit to the next world, into our grave, as well into the day of judgment by the gates of truth and honor. And we need that support, and we need that aid. So we should turn to God asking for that. But it's also an acknowledgement, again, of that state, that origin of the story that seems to be omitted. And then finally, I mean, there's a lot to add to supplications about love. These are just my own selective ones, because I wanted to make it not hours and hours, but just enough for us a little bit to maybe awaken us, shaken us, help us to reflect. Fear deeply embedded in love. Ibn Atha Allah said that whenever you're elated when given to, but unhappy when withheld from, you may infer from it you're still in your dependency, in your lack of sincerity, in your servanthood. If we reflect on that particular saying by Ibn Atha Allah, and then read, Qais ibn Ubaid said, Prophet Muhammad, upon him, peace and blessings, would supplicate to God, saying, O Allah, by your knowledge of the unseen, right? He doesn't claim to have knowledge of the unseen, and your power over creation, keep me alive so long as you know living is good for me. Cause me to die when you know that death is better for me. You want to go by the gate of truth and honor. Well, Allah, cause me to fear you in secret and public. Again, this is not a paranoia fear. This is a fear of acknowledging, you know, you're grateful for the blessings, the loving God, the patient God, the merciful God, and you don't want to lose this loving God, because he's not going to come after you the way the Pharaoh went after Moses. I ask you to make me true in speech in times of pleasure and of anger. I ask you to make me moderate in times of wealth and poverty. And I ask you for everlasting delight and joy that will never cease. I ask you to make me pleased with that which you have decreed, and for an easy life after death. I ask for the sweetness of looking upon your face, and a longing to meet you in a manner that does not entail a calamity that will bring about harm, or a trial that will cause deviation. You can see that love, again, you always want to see, you always want to meet the one that you love. Allah, beautify us with the adornment of faith, and make us among those who guide and are rightly guided. So again, fear embedded in love. These are just some of the supplications that he turned to God, asking and requesting in a state of gratitude. Now, again, he modeled it, he lived it. I don't claim to be there, think we all have to struggle as we're going up the mountain and remind ourselves of how he lived. Of course, some individuals, maybe they're a little bit deluded and they think that they are Prophet Muhammad, and they seem to be in denial of the transgressions and the abuse that they do engage in. But the Quran sometimes tells us that there are people, you know, who abuse others, and they may do so in the name of God, but they don't trick God with that, nor do they trick those who know God as well, like the believers. So to end, it's like mindfulness and faith. The outward show of faith shouldn't bring us self-satisfaction or entitlement. Any action, we should be mindful and conscious of why we're doing it. These acts are, after all, not just for our singular selves, they are also for God and for everyone with whom we're connected. Indeed, when we act for God, we become aware of the boundaries of ourselves and of others. And this is really, like I said, when some individuals are deluded, they're not aware of the boundaries of others. It seems like they will violate these boundaries mentally, emotionally, spiritually, not just physically, but they will continually keep scheming on how to violate these boundaries. And they do so through sinful cunning and in the name of God at times. A person can feel enlightened, but unless they're aware of the boundaries of others, that's not true self-knowledge. It's instead of a sort of narcissism. It's not uncommon for religious people to worship the command of God instead of worshiping God. But if we really feel that God is king, as we claim, then there should be a fear of being held accountable inside of us. You know, to you is the right to reprimand or to hold me to account until you are pleased. It doesn't matter who we are, what faith or of no faith at all. We must feel an accountability for transgressing the boundaries of others. If we realize our actions aren't only for ourselves, then we be aware of that. A disbeliever is not just someone who doesn't adhere to the faith. Disbelievers are also people who know the truth, like Satan, yet they conspire to hide it because it's of benefit to them. And so I showed that when he went as a sincere advisor to Adam upon a peace. So they will actively fight the truth through distorting it, brainwashing people to reject it, turning them away from knowing the truth and following it. These are disbelievers. So even though Satan says, you know, I fear God, he'll go and he'll plot and plan. And then after, like, humanity is misled or misguided, then he'll say, I fear God, the Lord of the universe. But you are plotting and planning to mislead the person, to distract the person, to misguide the person. How could that be fear? Fear embedded in love is not only a question of why we fear God, but also how we do it. And I showed, you know, Prophet Muhammad just through his supplication. Of course, if you look at other parts of the book, there's a section on Prophet Muhammad, beautiful prophet, beautiful messenger, which talks about some of his actions and some of the way that he lived his life, if you are interested in that. There's also a book on Prophet Muhammad by Ramadan al-Buti, which I highly recommend, because he studies the arguments that people have raised against Prophet Muhammad, and he beautifully kind of responds to those arguments with facts and evidence. If you dislike and fear someone, then you most likely want to escape them, like the Moses feared the Pharaoh, since you want to run away from people we hate. If we have a bad opinion of God, perhaps you imagine that God is just waiting to throw a thunderbolt and smack you for some ill deed, then you'll most likely be running away from him. Instead, we must embed our fear in love. In this case, we run to God. To understand this, it helps to think of someone who you love very much. Like I said, you know, we don't forget that origin. Don't lie through omission. Don't forget the origin of the story. That person you care about is displeased or angry at one of your actions, then you don't run away. Instead, you love for them forces you to care about their opinion or their knowledge. It's our fear of displeasing this beloved that makes us attentive. And that can help set us straight. So we shouldn't just fear God because we're afraid of hell or punishment. Of course, it's obligatory to seek protection from that as believers. Our relationship with God isn't just one of an abused victim with an abuser. We also should be afraid of displeasing a beloved. And this is something we can only do when we're fostering a relationship. You can see through the supplications how Prophet Muhammad was turning nonstop to God, even during the middle of the night, with God. When you have fostered this loving relationship with God, and you've done and said something that displeased him, then you're going to say, لَكَ الْعُطَّةَ حَقَ الْفَضَلِ. You really want God to be pleased with you. And it doesn't take much to please God. He's not like someone who's like displeased, you know, like how a narcissistic would be, like he's just displeased whatever you do. It's very, you know, a lot of simple things that you do, small, simple, good deeds consistently can please God with you, can have God be pleased with you. So fear-mongering and having a paranoia of God is not the same as fearing God. It's not being conscious of him, of him being majestic. Those who truly fear God are those who know and love God. They know themselves and they love God. They also know God. He's loving. He's grateful. He recognizes all good. They know that God doesn't benefit or gain by our punishment or anything good that we do. But there comes a time for justice if we transgress the boundaries of others. Fear of God should most certainly not be rooted in anger. And at its worst, this creates a situation that's ripe for brainwashing. And I gave like examples of religious groups sometimes might use the fear of God to brainwash people in society, if you will, as a way, some sort of like emotional blackmail. Certainly this lack of self-knowledge isn't just a state that religious people can manipulate. Anyone who's stuck in a situation of free-floating anger without a strong relationship to self and God could be ripe to follow a destructive leader. Instead, we really need to develop our relationship with God, our knowledge of ourselves, and let ourselves be guided by fear, again, a healthy, loving fear that will motivate and wake us and keep us conscious, that is deeply, deeply embedded in love. So I hope this presentation was beneficial, and I hope it has, I don't know, sparked some thinking or reflection for you to think about, and I do appreciate your feedback. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.